Hello everyone. Welcome to the new session of Paws webinars. We have today an interesting session, macro photography, especially the photographer talking about the small species that lives in our world. And today's the special guest, his name is Sandeep Das, and he has been doing this from long time, the genre of macro photography. He's also an award-winning wildlife photographer, and he have won many competitions, international and national competitions. So today, let's welcome Sandeep on the stage. Hi, Sandeep.
Hi, Hamas.
How are you?
Good. How are you? Good evening, everyone.
All good. Yeah, cool. Welcome to the show. And our audience would like to hear about you and your journey, how it started, how you turned into a macro photographer, all these things.
Thank you, Hermes. First of all, thanks for the opportunity. I'm Sandeep Das, and I'm from Thrissur, which is part of central Kerala, India. I have been photographing amphibians and reptiles. Like, even when we say macro photography, like, my area of specialization or my area of focus is mostly amphibians and reptiles. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. My area of specialization is majorly amphibians and reptiles. Because as a profession, I'm a researcher, currently a research scholar in Kerala Forest Research Institute. At the same time, I work on purple frog as a part of Zoological Society of London's EDGE conservation program. I'd been working on this purple frog for the last 10 years, but like the work on the purple frog had been supported by EDGE since the last 4 years. So I don't think I'll call myself a macro photographer. Like I said, when we see or listen macro photographers, most of them will be focusing on insects majorly,
yeah,
and or like smaller animals. But the subjects that I focus on are not as small as the insects that majority of the people capture. Of course, across the world, there are a lot of people now, they had been photographing the amphibians and reptiles since a long time. Yeah. But I guess like most of the people who had been photographing or who had been in this genre will be mostly researchers or people who work on these subjects, because we get to see them more or we get to be in the field more. Similarly, in my photography journey as well, I didn't take up photography I didn't come to photography as such. It was initially into bird watching, and at some point I realized that like it is very important or it is necessary to document what we see as a part of research or as a part of documentation also. So then I thought, okay, like why not get a camera, or why not start up photography? And that's when I was strongly influenced by photographs of Praveen P. Mohandas, who lives close by and who's always a good mentor, like a brother. He tells us things or he teaches things. He used to take us to the field, or we used to travel together. And it was at that point, I thought of I would love to have a camera. And it was way back in 2007, I guess. And I was doing my graduation. And when I kind of presented this idea in front of my parents, basically to my dad, my father, he was like, okay. So camera seems to be a nice thing. He didn't know that he was going to get into a trap. But instead of a bike, his boy is asking for a camera. And being someone who's into films or who's interested in films and all, I guess I caught him by surprise, or I made him fall into the trap very easily. So he said yes, but he didn't realize that like the camera or the things that I'm gonna need are way more costly or way more like problematic than a bike. Fortunately, he bought me one. With the help of Praveen, I got a body first, and like after some time, I got a lens. And then we realized that the body and the lens are not matching. Then I went back to this camera dealer. I spoke to him. I requested him. Finally, he managed to swap the body, and he gave me a new body. It was D80. I started with, and it was I was having a 170-500 Sigma zoom lens.
Yeah.
The fun fact is, like when I shot my first click, or when I was having that camera in my mind, I never know anything about photography. I mean, like I used to see photographs, I used to read about things, but I didn't know what shutter is, I didn't know what aperture is. Like, it was just like getting a cycle before learning how to ride it. But Praveen actually set it in the aperture priority mode and gave it to me. So I was just pointing it like a gun and clicking at everything what I saw. So it'll take 20-30 pictures, there'll be one in perfect sharpness or focus. And at some point I realized there is this plus and minus button. If you push that minus button, the light will go down. If you push the plus button, the light will go up. So it was a slow learning curve, but you know, like when we use something for a long time, you slowly kind of master it, or you'll slowly get the hint of how to go about. And it was during then I met Dr. Anil Sakriya, and I was introduced to the world of frogs. And during one of the field works, I actually, it was with Dr. Anil, David, and Sachin Rai was also with us. And we were there. I was not having a macro lens. In fact, I was not having a camera with me. I mean, my camera was at the college and I didn't take it. It was a quick trip and I went with him. And like everyone was photographing, there were a couple of tree frogs and they were breeding. And like all of them, like David and Sachin, everyone was photographing. And at some point I saw something. It's a normal scene, but it's not a rare scene and all. But I saw a frame. I saw something that will be slightly different. So I requested David and I borrowed his camera. And I took a click of that frame. I mean, it was a breeding pair, and like when everyone was photographing from one angle, I went top of it and I shot a picture from the above, and it looked a bit different for me, because that is what I always try to do. I mean, like try to see things in a different perspective. Might not be successful all the time. Everyone, every photographers have that thing of clicking a normal shot or a portrait shot all the time. That's the I guess like everyone struggle between clicking a normal portrait and going a bit ahead or beyond and clicking, yes, making a different picture. So every time we see a scene, like the first thing that will come to our mind is to like click a record or click a proper portrait. So to get over it, I think it will take some time. Every photographer might have faced it.
Yeah.
So like traveling or being with Praveen, that had helped a lot in that aspect. Like being with my father also has helped a lot in that aspect, trying to see things differently or try to present things differently, because everyone have the possibility or have the opportunity to see things, but trying to make a difference. I mean, like nobody wants to take the same frame every time. Everyone yeah, wants a different behavior or a different frame and everything. And it's almost impossible to click an image that has not happened, right? It might be something else. The subject might be something. Let's take an example of a hunt. There are n number of images of hunt, the cheetah hunt or leopard hunt or lion hunt. But the moment will be different every yes, time, or the frame will be different. There will be some photographer who had taken a similar shot of what we have shot like earlier, yeah, as well. So trying to make a difference is what we all can do. And for that aspect also, I used to watch photographers or like other photographers or people who win awards. So like following the Wildlife Photographer of the Year awards for a long time had helped a lot. I mean, like, the problem is if we watch those photographs, we'll feel like dropping photography and selling your camera. But <That's> yeah, <true. laughs> we'll get over it. And it had helped a lot in the learning or trying to see things differently. Maybe I'll start talking with the images. I'm just blabbering on my own. Let me share my screen now. One sec. So again, I guess this also works like Google Meet. I won't see what is happening in my screen once I click the share button.
Yeah.
Please help me with that. Kindly bear with me. Is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Can you see the frog image?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Yeah. So this is that image that I was talking about. And this was taken way back in 2010. And I don't know. I had that hinge and I had sent it for the Sanctuary Asia Awards that year. And that year, like, fortunately, I got a special mention for this picture. So this was actually a kind of, I don't know whether I can call it a turning point, but this was actually kind of thing that kept me going or like pushed me into photographing these amphibians and reptiles. Again, like I said, since I'm working on amphibians and reptiles, we look for them, we work in the field. So we get a lot of opportunity, but at the same time, it's not really easy to do or to carry out photography as well as the research together. So to create an image that is unique or different, you'll need that time, you'll need that effort, you'll need that process. And that always might not happen when you're doing a fieldwork, when you're doing a research and all. But like what I used to do is like I said, when I visit all these websites or social media profiles of all these photographs, I used to try and see as much as photographs as possible. And I used to keep all those frames or unique perspectives in mind. And if and all, when I get a chance, I'll try to make it happen. But again, like I said, like the images I'm just going to show, many of them are just portrait. For me as a researcher or a person who likes these amphibians and reptiles, these portraits are also special for me. It might not be the same for everyone. So these are three frogs, actually. So the fun fact here is, so the one in the middle is actually the female. And the others on top are the males. The behavioral aspect, the interesting part is that, so frogs, their fertilization is external, which means the female lays the eggs and the male reads the sperm onto the eggs in an external medium. It can be in water or it can be on a tree or a leaf like that. And this embrace position, it's called amplexus. So once a male and female
Sandeep, I think we lost you.
Explains during the slide.
Hello. I think Sandeep is having some internet issues. Sorry, guys. Let's wait.
Sorry, my bad. I didn't realize that I was away. I was just talking
no
to my
issues,
screen.
No issues.
till where did you listen?
The process of laying eggs on the leaves and.
I went too far. I've moved almost 2-3 images already. Sorry.
No worries.
Yeah, like basically, the one just immediately on the top of the female is the male that is involved in this breeding. And what happens is, like, after this embrace, it's called amplexus. Female lays the eggs and male release sperm onto it. It can happen in an external medium. In this case, it is happening on a leaf. Sometimes it will be in an aquatic medium. It can be in tree holes like that. And the other two guys are called satellite males, and what they are doing is they're also trying to deposit their sperm onto the female's eggs. So, like, maximum genetic diversity in a nature's perspective.
Okay.
So, this is a Malabar pit viper in its habitat, and this is something that I had been trying to do recently in the last 3-4 years. There had been several amazing photographers who had been doing the same thing since ages, like from South America, Africa, and all, having these kind of wide-angle macro perspectives of animal in the habitat. Like, because of not having the right gears or not having the right ideas, like, I guess, like, we are exploring this area only recently, maybe in the last 3-4 years only, we are getting a chance to see these kinds of wide angle perspectives. So even I started only recently, and I have only a handful of images which is in this category. I'm audible, right?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So this is a group of balsams, also known as impatiens, which was shot in Silent Valley. So when we follow these amphibians and reptiles, most of the time we will be traveling during the monsoons. Like, my work is majorly focused in Kerala part of Western Ghats, and I do travel a lot in our forest during this time. And that time is also a very good time for these kind of flowers. These balsams and orchids, they also bloom just after the monsoon showers. So we also get to see these kind of very beautiful, brightly colored flowers almost throughout during the monsoon period. I hope my slides are changing.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So, this is a frog called as Pseudophyllotus vinadensis. It's also called Vinad bush frog. This is one of the most common frogs in Kerala. It's the size of, say, like a paperclip. It's around 2.5 to 3 centimeters. And that bulge portion just below its throat is called a vocal sac. It's a male frog, and it's with the vocal sac, it is kind of amplifying its small sound so that it could reach its potential mates and also other rival males in their family. So they also, these tiny animals also defend their territory. And sometimes, like, when an intruder, when another male comes in, they also will have a fight, just like the wrestling. And, like, the one who taps out or the one who fails will move out of the territory. And the bigger one, or the one who fights and one who wins, will stay there and calls for the mate.
Okay.
So this is something very interesting. And photographing a calling frog is slightly difficult, because the issue is like many of them are sensitive to light, as in like they're shy, they're very shy. When we like shine the torch or when we pop up the flash, they'll stop calling. So we have to wait for some time, then like make sure the animal is okay. And when the rains and the conditions are perfect, then they'll be calling like anything. Then they don't even mind anything at all, like they don't mind the presence of anything. And that's when we used to get these kind of images with the vocal sac popped up with all those veins and all. So like I said, again, these are all documentation shots showing their naturalistic behaviors, like clean ones. Yeah, this is Gunther's vine snake. This is photographed from Anamalais, Munnar, actually. So here, the snake was resting on this fern. So some of them will be sitting exposed on the leaves, nice, waiting for their prey. And for some species, they'll be just relaxing after a day's hunt or after a day's meal, they'll be relaxing openly. Sometimes they'll just start moving away the moment you see it. Some of them like won't be bothered about the photographers or us at all. So here I just tried to create a different perspective with all those leaves and all. And obviously, like the aperture is somewhere around f/18, which gave this blacker, like blackish background.
Okay.
This is a kangaroo lizard. This is an animal which is found in the southern Western Ghats, which is found only in the Agastimalai Hills and southern part of the Kerala part of Western Ghats. So this is an animal whose relatives are found in Sri Lanka. So that Sri Lankan Indian connection is shown through their relationship. Recently, this was named as Agastigama bedomi. It had a different scientific name. Recently, the taxonomy was updated and it was named Agastigama bedomi, like after Agastimalais, and gama means lizard. So again, this photograph, like this is kind of showing its behavior. The reason why they're called kangaroo lizards is because like when threatened or when a predator comes, they'll just run on their two legs. So, like this guy was actually kind of like having, getting ready to run. And the moment they feel threatened, or the moment when predator comes, they'll just start running in the leaf litter. Mm. They're highly camouflaged. They are mostly seen in the litter. I think I forgot to include that image in this slide. Maybe like after this, I'll try to show that as well. This is the same species of lizard, just a portrait.
Okay.
This is the same species of the snake that we saw recently. It's called the Gunther's vine snake, and it has a characteristic slightly bluish green tongue. And this is in this image. I was trying to capture that tongue, and that the whole pose looked a bit different. There it is.
Wow.
So this is again one of my recent images, which is again one of my favorite. So this is the same species, Gunther's vine snake.
What lens have you used?
So this one I had used the Laowa 15mm wide angle macro.
Okay.
It's a tough lens to use. It took me almost a year to kind of master it. So the first year when I was using it, I barely got any images. I guess I had just one or two images with that lens after trying a lot. The issue is, like, it is completely manual. The moment you, like, attach it to our body, like, even the camera also starts acting weird. The focusing, aperture, everything is manual. But if you kind of start using and get that idea, or if you once you master it, it can give you like brilliant perspectives just like this. So here the mm-hmm. animal was actually lying on the fern, and it was like I was photographing with a normal 100 mm macro, and I changed it to my wide angle macro lens. I was sitting on the ground and I was like swapping my lenses, and this guy started coming downwards. So I lied downwards and I tried this perspective, and the moment I realized, okay, this is something not seen or something unique, not like not very commonly seen. I'm sure there will be a similar picture somewhere from somewhere in the world,
yeah.
Or in fact there will be a similar picture somewhere from here too. But I tried to get the animal as well as the habitat and the whole thing together. So there it is.
Yeah.
Again, I used an off-camera flash to fill the light, and I was also using a diffuser. I normally use the radiant diffuser. I guess Girish already gave a session earlier.
Yes.
So this is a same species, but this is a different color morph. Again, here also I was trying to get the snake and the habitat. So again, the issue with macro is that most of the time when we photograph an animal, size is kind of not up to the scale for the people who see it. So many a times when we give presentations or talks for students and colleges and all, like, they'll be like, ooh, this huge snake. So there we used to explain like how big it is and how small it is. The perspective is all what matters, and that's what giving you that, deceiving you of that like biggish feeling. It's another snake from the same group. It's a different species though. This is from the Nilgiris. It's called Ahetula Perotiti, which is also known as the brown-sided vine snake.
Okay. Oh.
These kind of things like happens. I mean, accidentally or by luck. So we were photographing the snake, and this was moving through an ant colony, and suddenly this guy kind of bit him. Like he's strongly biting him. You can see that in the image, and that's when he raised his head and he gave a look. This is one of the most beautiful frogs in the Western Ghats. It's called the Anamalai gliding frog. From the name itself, they have this capacity to glide from higher reaches to lower reaches. With all those. So their forelimbs and hind limbs, they have webs in between, and that acts like kind of parachute, and they'll glide from higher reaches to lower reaches. We've been seeing it rarely, so you can imagine how difficult it is to photograph them gliding. I don't think I'll be able to do something like that, because in all these years, maybe in the last 10 or 11 years, I have only seen them gliding once, and that too like very quickly. We need some high speed cameras for for videographing them as well. So this is also this is a Malabar pit viper, and I love that bluish white coloration there on the part, and it was slightly drizzling. I don't know whether it's visible in the screen, so all those tiny dots are droplets or rains behind. It got lost a bit because of my bad processing, but my idea was to capture that snake along with that tiny droplets of water. The issue is, like, most of the time for insects or something, or like maybe flowers or things, we can set up a tripod and get like images without much of shake and all. But with this, with these kind of animals, like amphibians and reptiles, sorry, like Vishu is happening and everyone's bursting out there on. So, like I said, like using a tripod in the field is not always possible. Like for some animals, yes, like we'll, if they are resting and all, we'll be able to. But most of the time, we won't have that like time, or we won't have that provision to use a tripod and make shots. Okay. But yeah, obviously, if you have a tripod, some clicks you can actually do wonders. This is another beautiful frog from the Western Ghats. It's called the Starry Night Frog. It's called Astrobatrachus kurichiana, named after the tribe's Kurichiar group, and named after the location, which is called Kurichiar Mela, from which the species was found. Again, like here we're trying to capture the animal with the habitat. This is in a tea plantation.
Okay. Does that image also use flash?
Yeah. This is used with flash. So, like I said, like some of these animals, like a portrait itself is very beautiful.
Yeah.
So this is one such snake. This is called the Bibron's coral snake. It's called coral because of those vibrant, bright red colors, just like the corals.
Yeah.
This is a bicolored frog. This is one of the most common frogs in our Western Ghats. And like you can see, like large number of these frogs moving in the forest floor during the monsoon. So again, I was trying to take a picture frame. this is actually a copied frame, I would say, because I had seen a very beautiful frame by a friend of mine, Vinod Venugopal. So he had shot a picture of the same frog just like this, but his frame is much more better because the individual that he saw like was like almost dark and the red eyes were popping out. So his image is like two red eyes popping out from the black background. So that image was in my mind when I was making it. Unfortunately, I couldn't click a picture like that. But yeah, this is something that made me happy. That look and those red eyes made it for. This is another beautiful frog species in the Western Ghats. It's called Blaira rubigina or Blaira ornita. There are two species. We still know which and which are found in different parts of Kerala. So they are found in streams, and like we funnily call them as disco light frogs, because like you say, as you can see, their underbelly they have these bright red with yellow patches, or sometimes bright black with red and yellow patches, which is really, really beautiful and wonderful. This is a cat snake. This is a yellow green cat snake. Again, very beautiful animal, and was trying to get an overhead shot with its tongue out. And those eyes, from the name itself, you can see their eyes. They got the name cat-eyed snakes or cat snake from their eyes.
Okay.
And this also was kind of experiment, just like the image that we had used in the poster. Had used the same technique here also. So these snakes also, they have this habit of like staying like motionless with an erect head and flickering their tongue. So this is again a rare cut and sink. So I wanted to capture that motion of the tongue. I was not as successful as
be the shutter speed you use?
This I'll have to check. This is somewhere around like 1/10, I guess.
Okay.
Again, like I said, this was without the tripod, only because that snake was like so calm and it was not moving, it was possible.
Great.
The other image, we'll talk about it when that image comes. It's the same snake in the rain, just wanted to capture the whole tongue and its head. This was one image, like, again, this is a very old image. I've got like one or two few small awards for this image. This is the blue tiger butterflies resting during their migration. So we saw an area inside the forest, like trees and all covered with these butterflies. And I was looking around and I saw this like root, not root, that lion lying down, going, touching the forest. And like while moving around, I saw this opportunity of like getting it in the white background, and the whole surrounding was almost dark shade. So this is just to try something different at the same time to document their behavior as well.
Okay.
Again, this is a very old image. This was taken in an 1855 lens, I guess, like taken way back in 2008 or 9. Here also, I wanted to capture the animals as well as their behavior and the habitat. But, you know, the limitations of an 1855 lens and shooting a macro subject with that. But yeah, I was somewhere happy about this. Is a male and a female, and they were kind of courting. The courtship behavior is happening. In fact, I wanted to have a bit more of the tree also, but unfortunately, this is by far what I could get. Hermes, you should tell me about the time also.
Yeah,
it might be going in bit too much. Yeah, this is just another calotus. It's called Monelisaurus kendocephalus. It's another beautiful calotus from the Western Ghats. It's called large-scale forest lizard. They have this vibrant colors. The males have this vibrant colors during the breeding season. Similar one. There's another beauty from the Western Ghats. It's called the cane turtle, which has that very beautiful red eyes. So I've had the opportunity, or I've had the luck to encounter a couple of them from the Western Ghats, and I've tried as much as frames as possible. So this is again how it looks like in the forest. And in the forest, this is very small. It'll just fit inside our palm. And finding them in the litter is not really easy. But the indigenous people in the forest, who live in the forest, they are very, very familiar with this species. And in some settlements, in fact, they keep these animals as pets for their children. They keep them in their homes. I mean, they have been doing it since a long time. In some places, department talk to them and release them. And most of the time, what we have understood is that like they'll keep them, and at some point they'll release them once the kids are bigger. But some other turtles, they do eat as well. These are like very tiny ones, and I don't think they'll eat them. And that's what we have understood from the interviews that we had with them. There's another beautiful frog from the Western Ghats. It's called Rhaucastus chalasodus. This is from the August Himalaya region. So when I see an animal, an amphibian or a reptile in the field, mostly try to click some documentation shots first, like a normal or clean portrait showing its characters, if possible, some behaviors or some key characters and all. And like maybe only later I'll try if there is a possibility for something different or something unique. So this is a chameleon that we photographed in the from Palakkad. Like I said, these kind of things are events that we come across while we are in the field looking for amphibians and reptiles, and sometimes we get to see these kind of really beautiful moments, like cicadas molting out, and sometimes we get to see fireflies in like thousands. So this is actually the time when these fireflies aggregate in large numbers. most of our forests are having nights with full illumination in many of our areas. I guess many of our friends are actually in the field trying to photograph the fireflies.
Okay.
This is another very interesting behavior. Like majority of the people in this field knows because since they don't have this, they don't have ability to close their eyelids, or they don't have a proper mobile eyelids. They clean their eyes with their tongue. And this is taken was cleaning their eyes with their tongue. And wow. You can see like how that top layer is kindly deflected or diffracted while it is cleaning the eyes. This is another cat snake which I shot like 2-3 weeks back. Again, for this snake, this like red tongue is very characteristic. So here I try to capture the tongue. This is a Draco. Flying lizard is a male actually displaying during their courtship display. So he was just flapping his dewlap like every now and then. And photographed it from my friend's house, in like Vinny Thetan's house. So we were all photographing and I was trying to get something different rather than a normal Draco shot, which is very common. Like everyone might have taken it. So this some kind of gave me a feeling of that like glow of that flap from the darkness.
Yeah.
And I wanted all those dark spaces around. And the light was really falling on the dewlap. This is a very old image. Again, like taken way back in 2018. It's a Drosera. This was shot from Madai Para. It's an insectivorous plant. It's a mosquito, I guess. Female mosquito is what I understood from some of the experts. Again, very, very old click of a spider in its web in an early morning. Another beautiful frog, which is called Rauquesus oclandrae. It's a reed bush frog. Similar shot of the vine snake in the rain. I've used a torch here. And I guess, like I've seen a lot of similar pictures from many good photographers. There's another pit viper. It's a hum-nosed pit viper. This is actually a pit viper resting, and that's an insect mosquito trying to feed from. Balsam impatiens. I don't know the species name, exact species name, sorry.
Oh.
Yeah. Wide angle lens, I also try to take images like this, which can convey a message.
Yeah.
And amphibians and reptiles are one of the major groups of animals that die on the roads a lot. Since they are very tiny and since they are very small, like they are least neglected. We are actually at the moment having dialogue with some of the drivers in some tourist areas in parts of Kerala, and we are trying to do some conservation awareness programs and all, just to see whether there is any behavioral change or whether there is any positive attitude towards stopping their vehicle for a moment for these kind of small animals or not, at least in places where roads cut through forest areas.
Yeah.
So amphibians and reptiles, they are masters of camouflage. This was an image which was taken from Madagascar, and that's a lizard that is on the branch.
Yeah.
And this is a close-up of that. So this is something that really amazed me, like some one sighting that I'll cherish for a long time. It's a species called Europlatus sicore. These are some of the eyes of the frogs, which are all photographed from Kerala, just so as to create awareness or create a positive change among people towards frogs.
To bring them closer.
Yeah. This is another favorite image of mine. This is again from the Nilgiris. So I've used the same set of Laowa wide-angle macro, and I've used an off-camera flash with a diffuser to get that dramatic lighting. This is an interesting species of frog which actually lives in streams. And they're also very small, like 2.5 centimeter to 3 centimeter long. And their calls might not be heard because of the water. And hence, they have this visual way of communication. They'll sit on rocks and they'll wave their legs. They're called foot flagging frogs. They're also called dancing frogs. This is another beautiful frog, which is also known as galaxy frog. It was called black microhyoid earlier. Now it's been called as galaxy frog. It has bright bluish dots and orangish pattern all over the body. So yeah, these geckos are really interesting. Like the kangaroo lizards, these lizards, they are actually ground lizards. They belong to the genus called as Cyrtodactylus. So these guys, what they do is, like, on the ground, and when they see a predator or when they see us, they'll just pause how they are and they slowly move their limbs, just as in a slow motion, just like seeing in movies and all. They slowly move in slow motion. And we will be startled by that behavior. And within a fraction of a second, they'll just run away. So it'll be like slowly moving this thing. And the moment, like, we look away or we look to another side, they'll just tuck, they'll run. And this was just before a similar moment. And was also cleaning its eyes in between. Again, like spotting frogs in daytime is a bit of a tough job because they stay concealed most of the time. I was trekking in the forest and I was walking and I was trying to hold on to a tree and suddenly this wetness touched me. Initially, I had a heart attack because, like, most of the time when we feel when we have that kind of feeling from a tree, we suspect a pit viper. Yeah. So I just jumped like backwards and only later I realized it was a frog sitting over there. And that's when, like, when a strong wind came, the light was directly falling on them. So it was kind of basking at the same time it was sitting concealed in the forest. Majority of the frogs, like, they are active at night, but some species which live in the streams and all, they are active in the daytime too. This is one of my favorite, all-time favorite images. Photographed it way back in 2011. So this is again a long slow shutter attempt. I was not having a tripod, so I lied down near the stream and I kept my camera over a rock and I clicked it. So all these colors are leaf litter that are in the stream, and the movement of the water made this painting kind of effect. So this is like one of my all-time favorite images. It's a very common frog found in the forest. So there were no other subjects and we had enough time. Our supporting staff were busy cooking food and it would at least take like 1 hour, 2 hour time to get the food ready. And I was having enough time to move around. And that's when I saw this animal, saw this individual, and I thought, like, okay, I'll attempt something. And during those days, I was also actively following the website called Creative Nature Photography. So Praveen only introduced me into that website, run by Ganesh, Shankar, Nilanjan Das, and all those people. So that website and the photographs in that website and their approach to photography had helped a lot in creating images like this. So to think like this or to create a unique perspective and all, like those learnings from, say, like 5-6 years back through that website had helped a lot. But again, like I said, like during field work, you might not get like these kind of long duration or long time to prepare and make a shot all the time. So yeah, when we get some time, we'll try and attempt something different. That's a vine snake. Like I said, like, yeah, this is another bush frog which is sleeping in the daytime. just to show how they are during the daytime. Nighttime, they'll come out and they'll be active calling. This is again another image with the wide angle. It's the same species, large-scaled pitch viper. Just to show the habitat, animal with this habitat. This is actually a cardamom plantation. Like I said, they're masters of camouflage. And these pit vipers are ambush predators too. So they sit and wait for their prey. And most of the time, they'll try to merge with the habitat. So they'll try to sit in places which match with their body coloration. So we can easily make this out from this photograph. But in the field, it's not that easy. It's very easy for us to miss this one. Like for their preys too.
Wow.
Yeah, this is that image. Like again, like trying or attempting this rare cut and sing had been in the mind for a long time. But like I said, we might not get time. The conditions might not be right. So this time it was right, and that the whole movement effect was created not just because of the single flash I was using, but also there was a light that was coming from the opposite direction. And it was that light which helped me in getting that illumination on that movement part. And yeah, thanks to the snake, which was not moving his head too much.
And what was the shutter speed, you remember?
This also I'll have to check. So, but yeah, it is somewhere around...
Roughly 20, 25.
Yeah. 20, okay. Around that only. Again, pit vipers. This is another beautiful frog, which is named as Raorchis Manohari. It's beautiful. At the same time, it was named in honor of T.M. Manoharan, who was the chief wildlife warden, not chief wildlife warden, who was the head of forest force for a long time. Again, we used a torch from the top side to get that shade or frog shape and photograph from this side. Habitat. This is again like one rare animal. This is the first photograph of this, the first photograph of a male of this animal, and this is the only photograph of the male of this animal as far as I know. I don't think anybody has a male photograph yet. Again, like lizard, Monilosaurus rooksi, from photograph from Palakkad. It's a baby of monitor lizard, Bengal monitor. And we were actually photographing the individual, and suddenly this plant hopper came in and sat on the head of the animal. Might be because it was attracted by the light that was coming from our equipments.
Yeah.
So some of my subjects, purple frog tadpoles. This is one image that I love a lot. I clicked this image in 2015. I guess like, yeah, the friends who were with me in those trips are actually watching this program, I guess so. we were there, we were going to Bandipur, and we took a stop at Gundalpet in those sunflower fields. And we were waiting for a couple more friends to join us. And during that time, like all my other friends, they were having those big lenses and long lenses, and they were walking around to photograph birds on these sunflowers. And like I did have a small tele lens with me, but I was not sure whether I should use it. I was just sitting near the vehicle and not sure what to do. And that's when I saw a lot of these bees flying towards it. So I'd seen a lot of images of bees in the flowers and all, but definitely there would be. But in my mind, I was thinking like, are there any images of the bees and the flowers and all together? I was having a 50 mm lens with me, And this is all what I could get with what I was having. I mean, I was not 100% satisfied, but this is what I could make out of from that situation. And this frame or that concept was in my mind for a long time. And I used to try that similar frame in my house or wherever I used to go. And when I used to see these bees and flowers or bees nectaring the flowers.
Okay.
And in 2018, this image was actually a result of that.
Okay.
I don't know, like the situations were perfect. We were there in that Kurunji Bloom area in Top Station in Yellapati area, and we were there and in cloud form, and we were actually photographing Kurunji, and yeah, like photograph Kurunji like in different angles, different planes, and I was thinking like what to do, and that's when like slowly when the sun started rising, there came a lot of these bees. And that's when I thought, okay, fine, I have a wide-angle lens now, and the conditions are perfect. Now I should try it. And I roamed around and I looked for flowers that was getting large number of bees, so that I could make the most of it. Because the lens is manual, and you have to be as close as the subject to get this kind of magnification, and you have to pre-focus it and click it. So it was not an easy job. I was there for almost an hour and a half. I got stung once or twice, but it was okay. It was not like a serious stung and all. And I sat there and I was clicking, and that's when the sun slowly started coming up. So I moved my position and I kind of pre-visualized this frame, and I was waiting for bees coming in and going out. So I have like some 50-60 images in the series, but this is by far my most favorite one, and this is one that Praveen selected from that lot, who helped me process this one. And this
That's
is the one which,
one
which won that award for the Kerala Forest
Department. Did you use any filter for this?
No, I should have. I mean, or I should have also tried using the flash to light up the bee, which would have been much better. But yeah, unfortunately. Like it was in the morning and I was not expecting to use a flash, so I just took like my camera and these two lenses and came to the field, and this is it. Maybe sometime in the future better this one. This is again a mating pair, so try to look them from a different angle. So this is again very interesting behavior. Here the adult is actually covering the eggs with mud. So that majorly two things. One, it won't get noticed easily. At the same time, it gets prevented from predators. The wine snake. This is another image. This is a normal image, but it's a rare event which happens very rarely. Yeah, this is another favorite of mine. This one won the Sanctuary Show second prize last year. Mm-hmm. And this was also in the WPOTY finalist in the last year. And unfortunately, it didn't go through, but yeah, happy it made that far. So this is a purple frog pair. And the naturalistic or ecological significance is that they are actually moving through the eggs of the toads. And the toad is quite an aggressive breeder. What happens is when the monsoon hits, the toad kind of gets into a breeding frenzy. And no matter what, it will try to mate with anything that moves in its way. And here the toad is trying to mate with a different species, which is the purple frog. So the whole setup, the eggs, toad trying to mate with the purple frog. And the purple frog, it is something that comes above ground only for a day in a year. It comes above ground, it stays a couple of hours, it lays eggs and goes underground again. Yeah. And that brief period, they're above ground is very crucial for them. They are open for predators. They have to go back before it gets day. Because like once the daylight comes, there are a lot of other predators that can also feed on them. So these guys are kind of taking their time away. So that's it about this picture. some photographs from the G6. There's a pair sitting with their eggs. I guess it's already 9:30. I'll just quickly move through the images. Again, this is a purple frog pair moving underwater, and the reflections made this pattern. That's a roadkill of the purple frog.
Oh.
This is a damselfly laying eggs underwater, and I photographed it from like above ground and like above water, and just like the other image, these reflections made that pattern.
Mm-hmm.
These are some perks of working on these group of animals. You'll get to stay in wonderful places. This is a soft-scaled viper, one of the big fours that is causing large number of casualties in India. This is again an attempt. So they do this like movement with their head constantly. It's not perfect, but still, yeah, happy with what I could get. This is a shot recently, two, three weeks back.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess I'll wind it up here. I guess I took almost the extra time than we expected, and won't stop. Just go on. Yeah, this is another favorite image of mine. This is a bioluminescent fungus. So a friend of mine actually saw it first while he was looking for frogs, and he told us like, yeah, this is happening in some places, and we went there. We were looking for frogs, and at some point, like. So while looking for frogs, when at night, we follow them by their calls. Most of the time, we follow them by their sound or songs or calls. And like I said, like some of them are shy or sensitive to light. And we switch off our lights and we stand still, listen to the call, walk a little further. Then again, like that, we spot them. And it was during one such incident, like when we switch off the light and we started seeing these kind of brightly colored, beautiful fungus like glowing all around us. And yeah, this is it. Like these were just found like one or two together. They were not found in like large numbers. Okay. So long shot of one. Yeah, I'll wrap it up here.
We don't want you to wrap it up actually. It is beautiful pictures.
Yeah.
Amazing, man. Amazing.
Thanks, Amis. Thanks a lot.
A lot of species which we have not seen even in pictures I have seen today.
Yeah. I mean, like Western Ghats is home to amazing lot of animals. Like we have around, let's take amphibians. We have around 450 or 500 animals, 500 species. Okay. And out of it, like more than 50% of them are found in Western Ghats. And out of this, around 90% of them are found nowhere else in the world, like just in the Western Ghats. Out of this 250, more than like 170, 180, they're found nowhere else in the world, just like the Amazon. Like we don't have that like huge numbers, but yeah, like considering that small area, the numbers we have is still very significant. Like they are very unique animals. Like for the general public,
a good amount of time, you'll get to see a lot of species. You can photograph a lot of species.
Exactly.
We have a question on that. When does the purple frog come out? Any specific month you are advised on how to find one?
They are active at the moment. And they come out depending upon the weather conditions, habitat conditions and everything. So you can see them starting from like say mid April and to say May end.
Okay.
It varies in different places. So if it's happening, it is happening in some places. Let's say if it's happening in Idukki now, it might not be happening in other parts, say in Silent Valley or in Nelambur side. And all. So it varies. But yeah, these months are the best time. And I have wrote a lot of articles, both in English and in Malayalam, regarding the same. And if you can read any of them, you'll know how and when they come out. Like what are the cues or what are the variables that decide their surfacing and all. And okay. You're always welcome to email me or message me. I am happy to share anything on these animals.
Sure. And how to take care of the camera gear on field while photographing frogs during heavy rains?
So, like, just like what we do all the time, we have to be extra careful. Because, like, you know, like, even though I use Nikon, I've been using Nikon since a long time, and I use Nikon all the time. And I guess it's comparatively better than other cameras in case of this weather ceiling and all. I have seen some of my friends having problems at the same time when we were kind of like happily using it in slight drizzles and all, not in torrential rains, but yeah. Most of the time we use umbrellas. We carry our gear and concealed in our bags, and we'll take it out only in an event of less rain or with an umbrella, or say like if I see an incident like a purple frog being eaten by a snake, even if it's raining, I might take it out because like it is something that interests me as a researcher. As a researcher as well as a photographer, it's like on both ways it is so special. Yeah.
And on that, Manaska has a question. Do your research help your photography, or your photographs help in your research?
Both ways. Both ways. I'll say like the research has helped a lot in my photography, because we know where to find them, we know how to look for them, and we know like what behavior. Just like people predict animals' behavior on game drives all those things. Like, like understanding these animals obviously helps you with your photography. And photography has played a crucial role in our research too. For example, if, like writing a paper or a research article or doing a research and providing a photograph of what we have seen or providing an evidence is also very crucial. So if I say like I'll write a paper, obviously the paper will get published saying that like I saw this snake eating purple frog. It will be there. But if it has an image, it will connect with the general public. It can connect with the general public with images. That's the power of photography. It helps us in connecting it with people. It helps us in conservation. It helps us in research, all possible ways. Yeah, I would like to put it in both ways.
Great. And what lens and flash diffuser you use to get these pictures, and which is your favorite, most favorite lens?
I use 105 macro, Nikon 105 macro. That's my favorite lens. And for the wide angle, I've tried a lot of these wide angle lenses, and right now I'm using the Laowa 15mm wide angle macro, which is slightly difficult to use, but yeah, it is a favorite lens. So 105 macro and the Laowa are my favorite lenses. And diffuser, I've been using the Radiant diffuser by Girish Gowda. It's a very handy one, and it's very easy to carry around in the field, and it gives very nice results too.
Yeah.
It's only recently we've been using these diffuser. Otherwise, until then, like it was just normal flash thing.
Have you ever faced any dangerous situations while in the dense forest of Western Ghats?
Obviously, a lot of times. But like we discussed initially, we go to the forest with people in the forest, mostly indigenous people and forest department staff. So whenever we work or we look for frogs or we look for snakes, there'll be someone who'll be looking after us.
Okay.
And most of our field works happens in the night or like in the darkness. So areas where we want to work at night, we'll use to scout those places in the evenings when there is light. So if there is any large animals or like elephants, they'll just move around. And like being in the field for a long time, you also get to know things. You will know the smell, you will know the sounds. So one thing that I've learned is like all my senses, like hearing sense or my olfactory sense, everything's very sharp. So I can listen, like by following these frog calls, or I can hear a squeak that is being broken by an elephant from a far off distance. We might not hear things that at home, but in the forest, it's it's super sharp. So yeah, we are always careful. In the field, we have bumped into elephants. We have bumped into tigers. Like I've bumped into a tiger in very close quarters. It was just like 2-3 meters from me. It was sleeping. I didn't see its head. And it was at after 1 or 2 minutes, I realized like, oh, this is the head and this is the tail. It was that close. The animal stood up and it looked at me, and I was frozen. I was scared. I was shit scared. I was frozen. I was not moving at all. And the animal just went away. So if we give them the space and if we respect those animals, like I don't say like it is 100% safe, but again, yeah, it depends.
Usually
upon
they
the
walk away.
Yeah.
Can you suggest any good book to learn about Western Ghats frogs?
To learn about frogs, I guess Dr. Gururaja's, there is a book on field book on frogs of Western Ghats. And recently, the book by David and all, it has got a lot of frog photographs. I guess a lot of frog books are upcoming. There are some books that are in the press, some books that are being prepared. And like the best thing is like follow the internet. The problem with amphibians and reptiles is that the taxonomy is changing. The name that you see now can change maybe in after 6 or 7 months. So it will be like that for at least for like 5 more years. And like by then there will be a like standard thing. So now the taxonomy is changing. It is more studies are happening. More people are working in the field. So updates are coming. Yeah, like follow the internet, or like there are several groups. There are Amphibian India, Frog India. There are websites run by National Center of Biological Sciences, which has photographs of so many amphibians. And follow these research people. You'll get to know more.
Yeah. Does normal wide angle lens give same result as of macro?
I mean, like I've tried using some of those lenses. Personally, I'm not happy, but there are people who are bringing out good results with normal wide angle lenses. It might be that like person bias, or like you said, like I am happy with this lens now, and I kind of mastered it. So like I prefer this one, but like some other piece will also. There are so many people who are doing this wide angle perspective in
I think you got stuck. Again, connection issue. Okay, guys, let's wait for Sandeep to come back, join back. Let's give 2 minutes. We have a couple more questions left. for Sandeep. I hope he comes back. Because of the rains and a lot of things going on. This place is having some issue in the network. Okay, he's back.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, no problem.
Stuck. Did I answer that question fully?
Yes. We lost him again. Yeah.
Yes.
Is it okay?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry.
No problem. So yeah. We have one question from Rais Rahman, a very good friend. How many gliding frog species in Western Ghats?
So gliding frogs, as in like gliding frogs, we only have four species. But when we come down, like there is another group called as bush frogs. They are the most represented group among tree frogs. Gliding frog, we only have four species.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is your favorite forest to photograph?
Which is my favorite forest?
Yes.
Agastemalais, I would say. Yeah. Agastemalais is my favorite place.
Okay. And do you have a goal in mind?
I mean, like the broader idea is to get these animals popular. And I don't know, like, maybe people in Kerala might be familiar. We are trying different approaches to get these animals popular. As a part of one of those awareness campaigns is what we started calling the purple frog as Mahabali frog. We connected the Mahabali story, Mahabali coming above ground for one day, with the frog story. And that really worked, and because it reached a lot of people. Also, we proposed to the Kerala Forest Department, Kerala State Government, to make purple frog the state frog, like just to show that like there are animals like these, there are unique animals whose relative is sitting just like thousands of kilometers away in Seychelles Islands, and leaving fossil or leaving evidence which proves India was part of Africa. So these kind of animals or these kind of stories should be available to everyone. So. Yeah, the broader idea is to create as much as awareness as possible, and thereby ensuring conservation or increasing conservation effort for all these animals too. I mean, conservation idea or conservation is happening all around the world, but most of them are revolving around our big animals, big or charismatic animals. These animals are also charismatic. They are also beautiful. They are also animals that should be conserved. So this is the broader idea.
Yeah, and do you have we have a question from Raghavendra. Your advice on frog conservation?
Just what we have discussed is an example. Our initial idea is to get as much as people into it. Like, if you want to conserve an animal or an area, the policymakers are the ones who have to decide. The people has to involve. So for all these things, we need people to understand that there are animals like this here. Yes. And these animals should be conserved. These animals should be a part of it. So I guess the first step is getting these animals popular, making them celebrities, making them superstars.
Yeah.
So I guess that's one way of like starting conservation efforts. So there are many initiatives that is happening across the world and across India as well. So there is a citizen science initiative happening on the Malabar tree toad. It's mm-hmm. a very nice toad. So normally we have, most of the people have this eerie or yucky feeling about toads. It's not that. Yeah. Like, we also saw some colorful toads as well. So yes. that's a very good looking toad, which is sought after by photographers. So Dr. Gurraja and his team is actually having an initiative, citizen science initiative, and mapping their distribution, creating awareness and all. They are having workshops. We are having workshops on the purple frog and some other species, creating awareness among the forest department people as well as the general public. We have to involve all the stakeholders involved, and that's the general public. So yeah, first step is getting them popular, getting people aware about all these animals.
Okay. One last question. Do you have any suggestions for someone who wants to do what you do?
Read a lot, then be in touch with people who are working in this field. We have a lot of good institutes in India who are working in all these aspects. There are a lot of workshops happening. There are a lot of courses. In an academic perspective, you'll have to plan when you are doing a graduation or an MSc and all. So be in the network of people who are in this field, which will help you learn a lot, to understand a lot, and plan your own project, plan your own works, or research ideas, all those things. Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Sandeep. Thanks a lot for sharing your knowledge, sharing your pictures. You, it was wonderful. Amazing, amazing session. Thanks a lot.
Hopefully thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Thanks. Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thanks for this wonderful opportunity.
You're welcome. So, see you soon.
Yeah. See you soon. Bye.
Yeah. Bye. So that was a very good session. Very knowledge sharing. I should say knowledge sharing session. A lot of knowledge about the amphibians, frogs, reptiles, everything. And thanks to everyone who attended the session. We'll be back next week with another wonderful session. So I'll keep you guys posted. Till then, take care. Bye-bye. Have a nice evening.